Welcome to Interviews with Inspiring People. My name is Gina Briganti. If you read my blog, then you know that we usually do these interviews as print interviews, but I was lucky enough to be able to interview my friend Susan Abbott, who is a very inspirational artist. Now, what inspires me about Susan is her openness and her light, which comes through so clearly not only when she speaks, but in the way she paints. The short story of how Susan and I met one another is that we were in the post office here in Joshua Tree in line, and somebody needed help in the line, and both Susan and I were helping this gentleman to figure out how to mail his package. Well, I was mailing a book, Susan was mailing a painting. It became very obvious that not only were we both helpful and open and friendly people, but that we were also kindreds, creative kindreds. So from there, we've built a friendship, and from that, I've asked her to be interviewed with me today. Susan, thank you so much for hosting me in the studio today, and thank you for agreeing to this interview.
Well, thank you, Gina, for having me. I've really appreciated the time, and the questions get me thinking about my art and inspiring and being an inspiration. So you've done that for me, too. Thank you.
Aw, see? That's why we're friends. So I'm always curious to know, well, what are you working on now, Susan?
Well, you know, some of the things you speak of about inspiring you about what I do inspire me, because I love the colors. And so some of my favorite colors are purple, turquoise, blue, and what I have on the easel, this I just completed yesterday, is a painting I'm calling The Greatest of Ease. And I just had this image of this woman flying. It seems to be a recurring theme of mine, of the woman with the open arms, in praise or in flight, winged figures, just kind of that open embrace, friendly, all that good stuff. But when your arms are open like that, you could also be flying. You could take off. You could. And so I find that, you know, there's a whole mythology about how we used to fly way, 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 way back. So I think I'm hankering back to that mythic place in my own soul and expressing that. So this being, I first visioned her in water, like she was coming up from a dive and there was more splashes of water. But then when I thought about it, or didn't so much think about it, but when I went with the flow of it, as it were, it was more like she was out in the cosmos with the moon and stars and the spiral energy, and, you know, she was a winged creature flying, and she was, you know, of course, purple, and in concert with the colors of the sky. And I'm also a big fan of the Northern Lights, so if I can put those purples and greens and turquoise together in some form, I'll do it. So I just was drawn to the, you know, the female form and being out, you know, superwoman, or just, I also thought of Tibetan dakinis and mythic figures in that iconography that can fly. And so in painting her, I just brought all that to mind. And when I thought of a title for her, it's just like, I was thinking of, well, she's like a trapeze artist. You know, she's released and she's, and what's that song? She flew through the air with the greatest of ease on her flying trapeze, you know, on the flying trapeze. And so this piece I called The Greatest of Ease. And so it was just kind of an interpretation of figures appear to me. It wasn't like I had a model for her, but the faces appear, and I always say, well, who is that? You know, who is that? And I'm not sure who she is yet, but she's somebody that is moving through the world with ease and grace. And sometimes they say that we paint or we make art to make up for a lack in our own world, in our own worldview, and maybe that's reflective of my own difficulties with mobility of, you know, having a bum knee and a bum hip and being able to move that freely in the world. And I think that, you know, spiritually I am moving that freely in the world, and it just boggles my mind that happens, but it does. So that's, I think I paint sometimes to inspire myself, because there's much ugliness in the world, and so it's kind of like, yesterday was 9/11, and that's what I painted yesterday, and that was kind of my medicine, if you will.
My next question for you, Susan, is what do you love most about painting?
Well, that's a good question. And when I reflect on that, it's what I love most about it is a feeling of freedom and a feeling of being able to express that way with color. You know, it's just a miracle to me. And much more a miracle when I can paint an image that almost looks like what it really is, and then also to play with images. I mean, so I've done some dream paintings that are dreamscape type things of figures of mermaids or Medusas. There was a call in the community for Medusa related art last spring, and I just kind of went a little crazy with it, because Medusa has been a figure in my back of my mind for a long time, mythical sort of woman who's been wronged and misrepresented in life and art. And so this Medusa theme was a way to, you know, get at some of that. So I did several Medusa scapes, if you will. And but being able to have that freedom of imagination, the freedom of curiosity, to explore whatever I want, to make something pretty, to make something that might even be move people in a way. If I'm not moved by my art, you ain't gonna be moved by it. So, you know, there is that movement in my work that moves me. So if I'm, you know, the figure that I spoke of earlier of the flying woman, that image is very evocative to me of a lot of ancient yearnings, and it's a place for me that is healing. I think every time I've started to do some art, and then in the last 5 years I've just came out as an artist. It was an evolution. And
now that you've had a chance to see and listen to Susan talk, I know that you can see how inspiring she is and how inspired she is. Well, now I'd like to find out from Susan who and what has made you into the person you are today. What has made you this wonderful person?
Well, I'm gonna say everything and everyone has had a say in that, or a piece in that, whether I can consciously tell you who it was or what it was at all time, but I think everything that we interact with affects us in some way. So I'm going to say that. But more specifically, I feel like I was raised in a family of, I say a matriarchal family, in that I had two mothers, my grandmother and my mom, and three sisters. So it was a very female-centered household, and you know, I feel like that, to see women come up in the 50s and 60s and single parent and all that kind of stuff, you know, I said, my mom, I'm amazed what she pulled off in the 50s and 60s, raising four girls. And she would, I remember her getting us all collected and carting us off to the beach on the bus. And I'm like, I can't even imagine doing that. So she was an inspiration to me, and she worked as a nurse, so she was a very caring person. My grandmother was a very funny person. She was a baker, cook, you know, cheap cook and bottle washer, and my mother was kind of the breadwinner in the family. So the two of them were always very supportive, and I had an aunt, a great aunt, who always pushed education. You know, she said it's important to go to school, and so she, you know, she was definitely an inspirational person. Teachers along the way, even I want to say the old battle axe teacher is probably the most inspiring teacher. So the person that kept me on task with the English teacher, that got me reading, things like that. I didn't really explore art in school. And I mean, I always liked it. There was museums handy by. I was more of a music person. And I played the saxophone. So I think I got, you know, that kind of practice idea of... So I was more music and a writing person than a painting person. But I've always loved art. And I remember in the 70s, I was in women's studies and, you know, took some art history of women that weren't in the world of art, that had been neglected. And at the time, a painter or artist by the name of Dewey Chicago did a piece called The Dinner Party. And it was a sculpture piece, what they would call an installation piece, of her imagined conversation between, or settings at a dinner table of 39 different women in history that most of us didn't learn about in our history classes. And it was an amazing, she had dinner plates and, you know, table runners and all this kind of stuff for women artists that, or women healers, or women philosophers that hadn't been acknowledged. And so that was a huge thing. It kind of exposed me to the art world, really, in terms of we took out a membership to the museum while it was in place. So there was this whole flourishing of women's arts. I took classes at San Francisco State in writing. There was one... A wonderful filmmaker named Allie Light, she taught a class called Woman as Creative Agent, and she gave us all these projects to do of self-portrait or body image or, you know, my story in a box kind of things that were just projects that had us let loose about creativity, really. So Women as Creative Agent, and that, you know, she was a very inspiring mentor in her way. And she's a filmmaker, and, you know, I haven't seen her in a while, but we've had a friendship and kept up over the over Facebook. So, more recently, I was taking a class on Aramaic Bible, and we had a teacher there, Reverend Dr. Joanne Coleman, who, for her assignments, she gave us art projects. She didn't want to read papers, no. But she would have us write poems. She would have us do, you know, what did the subject of this class mean to me in a box or a sculpture? And so sometimes I did paintings for that. And she was very supportive and encouraging. And she was over at the house one day, and I showed her some of a painting I had done. And she says, oh, you know, you can do this.